All right.
All right. Well, I guess we'll get started. Welcome, everybody, to another edition of the Omaha Bar Association Young Lawyers Division, Just the Basics CLE. Thank you for showing up on a beautiful day. We have the window open so we can get a little bit outside in here. This is the continuation of our Just the Basics series. We have cast presenter in the room, Tom Gross, who did criminal law back in the day. And now we have health law as our topic for the day. We have Whitney West from CHI, and we have Travis Tettenborn from Cline Williams here to give us an overview of what you need to know in the health law area of practice. We have Facebook Live going for live and on-demand watching as well. And if you like what you see, come back. We have plenty more coming up this year. We have elder law, May 21st, business law, July 17th, legal issues related to veterans on August 7th, and the tax law one sometime in the fall. Date still to be determined. So if there's something that you want us to do for this, let me know. It's easy as that. And we'll take a break about halfway through for anybody to get another drink if they want to. And I'll turn over to the panelists.
Thank you, Dave. If anyone can't hear us, please let us know. We've got the window open. Hopefully you can hear us on the live feed. Thank you to Dave for asking us to come here today and speak with you. And a special thanks to Dave for all that he's done, specifically for the Young Lawyers Division. I know you all probably get the emails, all the different events, the baseball game, the hockey game, the trivia nights. Let's just take a second to acknowledge Dave for all his hard work. All you guys are doing. So before we get started, let's get a sense of the audience. We won't have much mandatory participation. We're mainly going to talk at you for this hour. But
this is it.
Yeah. Just a quick show of hands. Let's get a feel for experience level. 0 to 3 years of experience. Any 0 to 3 years of training? Okay. 3 to 6. Okay. And then above 6. Okay. How many primarily litigation work? Okay. I think it was transactional. I don't know if you have a better way to describe it.
Yeah.
Transactional work? Okay. So we've got a pretty good mix of just all across the board. So, this is just the basics. We'll try and touch on the basics of our experience and what we do, what our role is in the healthcare industry. If there's anything more specifically you want us to nail down or go into more detail on, please raise your hand, interrupt. This is meant to be an informal setting. It's meant to be an informal talk where we can share whatever experience might be helpful to the audience. So please feel free to interrupt us if there's any questions that you have. If you need to wait until your second or third drink to work up the courage to ask a question, that's fine too. So why are we here to talk about health law? Short answer, it's a $1 trillion industry. It's 15% of our country's GDP. There's a lot of legal work to go around. There's a broad range of legal work. Looking locally, UNMC, I don't know if any of you saw, did a good study that they released in February of just a survey of the practitioners in the state, just to kind of get a sense of who the individual providers are. We've got 4,800 physicians here in Nebraska. We've got 908 physician assistants, 1,500 APRNs, so that's going to comprise your NPs, your certified nurse midwives, clinical nurse specialists, and then your CRNAs, and then 27,000 RNs, and then 5,600 LPNs. So,
and that's a shortage. We are in a nursing shortage, so that's not even, our full capacity.
Numbers-wise and distributed geographically.
Yeah.
That's one of the takeaways, or at least one of the items that got picked up from that study is 13 counties without a primary care physician. Same number without a PA. If you're interested just in raw numbers, I encourage you to Google that study. It's got a lot of good information. That helps us put it into perspective, I think, What I say from the outside, being outside counsel, is the clients I serve have the goal of saving lives, and that's a pretty noble pursuit. And especially from the inside, I think it's even more special to be able to say that we're a small part of that. So we kind of try to keep that in perspective as to who is actually out there treating the patients and what small role we play in that whole process. So my role as outside counsel, I do primarily medical malpractice defense work. 90 to 95% of my practice is litigation. I do a lot of commercial litigation as well, which will naturally spin off with healthcare providers if they have a litigation issue. But that's generally my experience. You can share your role.
Yeah, so I'm primarily transactional. I spent a couple of years at Bear Home here in town in their healthcare group before I moved in house. So they're just basically a number of kind of regulatory compliance stuff for mostly hospital clients. And at CHI, it's been a little, I'm coming up on 4 years at CHI, it's been a little bit of the same, although we have more client staff. So I kind of moved out of that role a little bit where I was getting coding and brilliant questions, more into some more interesting questions sometimes, or scary questions, but never really communication stuff. So purely joint ventures, all of our physician contracting, ABC contracting, whatever issue for A to Z comes up. So.
Yeah, you said A to Z, I mean it.
Something new every day.
Yeah, when we're asked to wrap our arms around the topic of health law, it's pretty impossible to do because it is such an all-encompassing area, especially with the issues we deal with in the house. What I tell in our recruiting events, there are law students that will always ask a question related to, well, I've got so-and-so that I'm related to that's in the medical field, I'm really interested in health law, how do I get here? And what I say is just do as well as you can in every single law school class because you're going to use every single law school class. If you get into this field. So, why don't we get into some of the specific areas of the law that you encounter, Whitney, from the in-house perspective of CHI. Tell us kind of what are the big issues we need to know to the extent we can narrow that down to a handful we can cover here.
Right, so I have tried to narrow down topics to a few bullet points with the goal of, with kind of a diverse audience, just giving you an idea of maybe kind of issue spotting areas if you're not a healthcare lawyer and you're dealing with a healthcare client. So the big one that we run into, especially with people who haven't worked with a lot of healthcare clients before in our system, is when we're doing joint ventures or employment or any sort of contract with physician groups, and we have to be concerned about STARK and anti-kickback and fraud and abuse laws. And if you are not in healthcare, you don't have to worry about this as much. They are not fun. If you, so STARK was named after Senator STARK. He passed it, I think that was in the 90s or 80s. It has since had exception after exception after exception. So there are rulemaking phases of 1, 2, 3, like 2B. I mean, it's a disaster. But basically, STARK prohibits a doctor from ordering services for Medicare patients from an entity in which the physician or members of the physician's immediate family have a financial relationship. And financial relationship is defined very broadly. So any sort of compensation, if you're an employee, if you're an independent contractor, serving as a medical director. So these seem like little things, but especially in smaller communities, it turns into a big deal where if you're Grand Island, you have the outside practice and one of the doctors works for CHI, another, you know, his spouse is in the independent practice. It gets kind of messy very quickly. But the issue with STARK is that you have to fit into one of these exceptions. So again, many exceptions. There's exceptions for employment, physician recruitment to rural areas, space leases, equipment leases, electronic health records, accountable care organizations. So there are exceptions you could fit into to meet to meet the requirements of Stark and still consummate the transaction. But you just have to be sure to meet all those elements. The one we run into the most is not having a written agreement signed in advance by all the parties that sets out the compensation that will be paid. And the other big issue is fair market value, and that is basically what you would pay if there if you weren't considering any sort of business or referrals being passed between your two parties. So we have there's a whole cottage industry of healthcare appraisers that we engage a lot to get fair market value appraisals, and it can sometimes get a little bit silly. I closed a transaction last week where we're divesting a group and one of our physicians wants to take it independent and continue. And the HCA came in and evaluated the practice, and they're evaluating everything from the ballpoint pens to the vaccines to the x-ray machine or whatever. And so, you know, his lawyer came back and was like, well, you know, these pens and office supplies are HCA is saying that they're like $10 a notebook, which is ridiculous. We kind of are stuck with that, and that's, as a big health system, one of the things that just we don't have a whole lot of leeway with. Once you get a fair market value opinion, it is a range, but that's just something we run into a lot. The other big fraud and abuse issues are anti-kickback statute, and then False Claims Act and billing and coding issues, which I don't want to get too into the weeds there, but these are the fun ones, like the civil monetary penalties law and the QTAM cases where you have whistleblowers and you're getting trouble damages. Along the same lines of Stark, but basically it's a felony to knowingly, willingly, or willfully solicit or receive remuneration in return for referring to patients or business that's paid for by a federal healthcare program. And this includes discounts and freebies too. So this constrains a lot of what a hospital can do in terms of, can we restock the ambulance for free if they brought patients? That kind of stuff. So it's a lot of things that you wouldn't even think are all that problematic, but they are, and they're strict liability statutes. Anti-kickback does have an intent requirement, which helps a little bit, but you still don't want to be in a situation where you're facing anti-kickback liability. So if you're new to this area or ever encountering these issues, the OIG has a ton of advisory opinions and special fraud alerts. They all do a very good job of setting out the basics of these laws and explaining exactly why, under a certain hypothetical circumstance, a situation would or would not be okay, which are really helpful if you're not super, you know, involved in this area on a regular basis. Very briefly, so HIPAA and privacy issues, obviously, I mean, that could be almost everything. Travis and I were talking beforehand about this presentation, could be a full day, if not longer, presentation. So HIPAA is definitely one of those where I hesitate to just touch lightly on it. We're just going to touch lightly here. For you guys who I think are, this audience is a lot of lawyers in private practice, the one issue that, you know, I think everyone needs to be aware of if you're dealing with healthcare clients is whether or not you're a business associate of your healthcare clients. So if you're, so OCR, for instance, they have a specific example where they sanctioned a law firm. The law firm had a pharmaceutical company as the client and received patient information in the course of representing the client but had no business associated with it. So it seems a little bit basic and kind of silly, like what's the point of just having one contract, but they are auditing this. People do complain about this a lot, and OCR has a really high rate of looking into those complaints. It's not like just sending it out into the ether. So yes, go ahead.
I have a question.
Yes.
It's like not directly related to anything other than HIPAA. So if you want me to wait, I can wait.
No, please.
So I'm a criminal lawyer, so this is going to be like not so. So in the course of discovery, if I get a medical record from someone and say like a sex assault case where an accuser has signed a release so that the prosecutor can use that in prosecution of that,
I mean, the key is there that the individual, you have an authorization to have the information.
Right.
So, I mean, I don't know. I feel like it's more of a litigation issue maybe, but yeah, if you can use it in one case.
Yeah, I think it's a question of whether or not you have an obligation to either restrict its use to that, the case in which the authorization was given, or that there's no requirement to destroy the records after that case.
Right.
So, in terms of records, it's really depending on whether you're restricting that scope.
Yeah. And
without looking into the HIPAA, which I've never confronted the issue.
Yeah. I called the Board of Ethics and they had no idea.
I for sure don't want to opine. I mean, if you are a business associate, if you're acting in that capacity, you have a specific relationship with the client. So, I mean, to use something in one case that you were hired for, where you have an authorization, and say you have a really good response, but lots of public information come out.
Do I have a duty to a patient who, like, I just got those records with the patient, made an allegation, and they got released? I got the records and started discovering in one case. Do I have any duty to a patient as a lawyer?
If you have a business associate agreement, you definitely do. So then I can look at the terms of the BAA. Because it basically holds you as the BAA, or the BAs, rather, the business associates, are acting like in the shoes of the covered entity. So they can't do anything that the covered entity couldn't do.
Right.
That said, most HIPAA authorizations are drafted very, very broadly.
Right.
And so it's kind of like if you have a super broad patient authorization, I think there are a lot of cases where even the covered entity can do a lot with that.
So can you comment for a minute about the propriety in that case where you get a record in case A that you want to use in case B, but you don't care about the patient, you care about the provider's procedure. Redacting out the name and date of birth of the patient. As I understand, once those two pieces of information are gone, everything in the document ceases to be protected health information.
So maybe, yes.
Okay, so that's the question.
So under HIPAA, there's a whole list of, and there's also, Nebraska has kind of beefed up its reach notification law on what constitutes personal identifying information. But generally, anything that can identify the patient under HIPAA is what they use, which in most cases you would think, okay, the patient name and date of birth, or patient name and social security number, or medical record number that incorporates social security would be enough. But I can't say that that's a black and white rule, because there are also situations where there are tons of identifiers that OCR lists, and like especially in a small town or where you're dealing with a small subset of people, you could still not have the name or birth date, but it might be enough information that they would think you could identify the person. So then it's more a question of what to redact.
So on that, like, high profile case, so the media, like, would that be, like, you identify that person if you identify the defendant who was in the media, would they say, oh, we probably eventually figure out who the...
That's a good question. I mean, in that case, if there was already that much that was public, would it have already ceased to be any sort of protected health information?
Yeah, and I'll pose this to the group. I don't know if anyone has any thoughts, but an active issue that we're looking at in some cases, and so I'll try and describe this as generally as possible. The elements of the claim alleged against my client require, arguably, introducing evidence of medical treatment of other individuals. And there are witnesses in these cases that are willing to provide, arguably, protected health information about other individuals, and we are struggling, or at least working through with all the attorneys, both in other ethical issues, but also under HIPAA. How do we deal with this where, in order to prove your prima facie case,
you need to
show this, and you don't have these individuals, you don't have witnesses, you don't have other than calling Whitney, we haven't gotten the answer to that question.
I don't know if you want to call me.
Yeah. But it seems like your jumping off point is to start with a protective order that says wherever this stuff goes, it can only be used for this case, and then it either has to be returned or destroyed after the appeal process has been exhausted or something like that. If you have that in the hypothetical with the medical record in case A and wanting to use it in case B, well, there's your answer. The protective order says you can't use it.
Yeah, and again, the authorization, I mean, anytime you're in litigation, like typically like a worker's comp claim or, you know, there's a personal injury case, the patient is willing to sign an authorization, and I would look back to see exactly what they are authorizing as well, because that...
But as a lawyer representing the patient, you may want to think about taking that extraordinarily broad authorization and tailoring it down, putting a time limit on it, looking at what you can get and what they can do with it.
The other point I wanted to touch on that's relevant to litigators, and we get these requests all the time, and I've had to kind of learn this since I've never done litigation aside from like Medicare cost support appeals, are when we're releasing records and records that are subject to more stringent protections than HIPAA. So I'm thinking primarily of the CFR Part 2 information, which is substance abuse and alcohol. Counseling information, there are stricter protections in place under federal law for those records. And then mental health information under state law is also has a different set of rules for disclosure. So sometimes we'll get from an attorney a subpoena that requests records, and we can tell based on the case that what they really want are mental health records. But if you don't kind of cross certain hurdles, we can't provide that more. So we like getting subpoenas. I totally really want to say that, but I kind of do, because we also get a huge health system here in Nebraska, Western Iowa. We get a lot of more informal requests, and we're very much like, we want to work with you and whatever, but in the end, the safest thing from our perspective as a provider is usually to have a subpoena. So almost always, even if we're going to say, hey, we'll work with you to schedule an interview with our doctor or whatever it is we need, we're still maybe going to require that you go with a subpoena, which I know is kind of annoying, but it is the most protection for us as a healthcare provider, especially if later things come up. And I think you had a situation this week with this where we want to have the ability to quash it later on should we get 18, you know, requests down the road.
And there's a practical aspect from my point of view, which is you give an inch to an attorney that's looking for anybody on behalf of a plan, they're going to follow up and want to speak to that, right? And so let's make them follow the proper channels and get that.
Yeah. And just a shout out, I'll call you guys, but if you have any subpoenas to serve on any CHI Health locations, since we are so spread out, we recently set up an inbox with a crowd of this called Subpoenas at Allegiant.org that we're trying to direct all lawyers to send subpoenas to. So just a quick PSA while I have a captive audience here.
Have you had a great number of orders come in with judges that may be the least restrictive alternative finding for the mental, either the mental health or the substance abuse records? Because, I mean, they're supposed to have a hearing and do all these things and make all these detailed findings.
Right.
And my experience in litigation is as soon as you tell the judge exactly what you're asking them to find in order for you to get the records, the judge says there's no way in hell I can make that finding. So, good luck.
That's a good question. I don't really handle them once they're to that stage.
Yeah, you would only see the order.
Yeah,
that
I would only see. Yeah, I only kind of see the beginning, and then I don't know, maybe the end. I don't see what really happens in the middle.
I haven't identified that issue, so I don't have a repository of orders that I can send you on that.
My perspective is more when you get the subpoena and you figure out what they're asking, I'll raise the issues of, okay, wait, they're asking for these records. This is one of our psychologists or psychiatrists, and I foresee there can be issues.
So assuming that the subpoena seeks only PHI, but not drug and alcohol treatment, and not
not mental health crisis, but it's just lab results are boring stuff. Has it been your position that if the subpoena complies with the Nebraska discovery rules, that the HIPAA requirements have been exceeded by compliance with the state court discovery?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's been our analysis as well.
Yeah. It's all of those permitted disclosures, we feel better if we can have a required by law disclosure and we have a court order or subpoena. So that's kind of, I understand it's an outside attorneys from time
we
to time.
We have no problem following.
I mean, it's, yeah, that.
You
that,
just wish everybody else would.
Yeah, well, and I get it. Sometimes it's hard when it's a permissive disclosure from the provider's perspective, and we don't want to be a roadblock necessarily, but sometimes it, yeah. We give an inch, and then it turns into a saga, and then we wish we hadn't done it, so.
Any questions?
Well, no, I was just going to make a comment. Whether you're a plaintiff's attorney or a defense attorney, if there are records that are irrelevant to whatever it is you're trying or litigating, I've been successful just doing a motion to eliminate beforehand, and then they can't talk about it.
Good point, yeah. So I didn't have all that much more to say about HIPAA, really. So I'll move on, and I'm probably getting a little close on time. I did want to talk, and I think this will be relevant to you, a little bit about the peer review privilege in Nebraska, because I think that's relevant to transactional and litigators. So just for background, I'll be very fast here. We've got the Healthcare Quality Improvement Act, HICWA, federal law which provides limited immunity for healthcare institutions if you take disciplinary action against a member of your medical staff, but you've provided certain due process protections. So like 30 days to respond to a notice, the ability to have an attorney with you in a disciplinary hearing, that kind of stuff. HIPAA also establishes the National Practitioner Database, which you may have heard of, NPDB. And that gets tricky. So that's a reporting requirement. Anytime we actually take a professional review action based on somebody's professional competence or conduct, and it affects the provider's clinical privileges for more than 30 days, although we can get into the weeds a little bit on what 30 days is under certain circumstances. Anyway, the point is that it has the potential to ruin a physician's career if you're reported to the data bank. It's intended to, you know, not let a bad doc go from one hospital to another without hospital B knowing what they did at hospital A, which is a very noble thing. But in the details, there are often reasons, and sometimes good, sometimes bad, from my perspective, that the doctor can kind of argue some technicalities, and maybe they shouldn't really be reported because it's kind of a severe action to take. So I don't know if that's any of you are ever faced with, but it's just something that I think we see doctors in the community, once they realize they have the ability to get an attorney's representation, if they're facing any type of licensure or NPDB report, that's like a very kind of complex area. But we can provide, there's a bunch of information I have on that.
And any type of settlement of an action where money is paid on behalf of the doc. Triggers the reporting requirement, which is also something that
Is that database then accessible by other potential employers but not by members of the public? So Dr. X settles 10 malpractice cases for $1 million a piece.
Yeah.
Methodist could find out about that if he applies for employment with them.
Yeah, Methodist can for sure find out. I should definitely know this, but I don't know if I can just go on and search on that. I'm pretty sure that you have to be kind of registered and have some sort of
proper purpose.
Yeah, as opposed to just me as a member of the public being like, I just want to know if my doctor down the street has ever been reported. I think.
I was at a conference a couple months ago where one of the employees from the National Practitioner Database actually came and gave an hour-long talk on it. Very helpful. I remember looking up online. When you pull it up, I don't know if there's a login established credentials that you actually have.
during the break.
Okay.
So the other thing, just to briefly touch on before I turn it over to Travis and maybe take a drink break, is so the Nebraska Peer Review Statute, this was revised or, well, basically rewritten in 2011, and it provides an additional level of protection for peer review materials at the state level. So Nebraska's law is pretty good from a healthcare provider's perspective. It doesn't just apply to hospitals, it applies to even clinics or any sort of association of healthcare providers that are engaged in peer review activities. So obviously we want to encourage peer review activities, evaluating quality, competence, all of that stuff. The trick is that you have to enjoy this immunity, you have to be providing information to or participating in a kind of designated peer review activity on behalf of a designated committee that the governing board of whatever you're in has designated as peer review. So they may have a different name. In the hospital setting, we have utilization review, there may be quality assurance, incident reports when we have a potential patient safety event. If these are funneled through the correct committee, and so for a hospital, it would have to be, hey, we as the board of directors of the hospital say committees A, B, and C are peer review committees. Those enjoy a very strict privilege. And that applies not just to the institution, but also to the individual practitioners who participate on those committees. What we run into, I think, is that it's very easy to waive a privilege. If you have different committees that are doing, you know, different things, but also all involved in the same incident, it can get a little murky. So the key is if you really want to preserve, you have to just make sure it goes through that correct committee or correct group. And then from there, all proceedings, minutes, etc., have to be, you know, completely confidential.
Yeah, and that's critical from my point of view, because I respond to discovery requests all the time asking for anything and everything from
right.
Any type of peer review investigation or any type of investigation of peer issue, and I need to make sure that we have all of our proper procedures that have been set up to make sure we have anything.
And this extends in Nebraska's law extends to compliance committees. So if you are just evaluating, are we in compliance with the conditions of participation as a emergency facility or as an acute care hospital? Those proceedings can also be protected by our peer review statute, but the same sort of standards apply. I mean, of course, the peer review privilege is never going to protect something that is available from another source. So if you can subpoena the medical records, I mean, you can use whatever's in the medical record, despite the fact that this case also had an incident report that went to a peer review committee kind of thing, that you just would be constrained to discovering what was in the kind of original source as opposed to what came in the protected channel. So
you're not shielding the underlying facts by doing
right.
If you're in the process.
So I have more topics, but we're already kind of over, so I'll pause for a minute.
She'll be in a couple minutes. So if we want to take a break, everybody, if we need to use the restroom, order another drink, we'll start up in 5 minutes.
And
you guys can figure out the.
Travis will tell you the actual, like, really exciting.
Yeah. And then the CLE will begin.
Yes.
I just walk outside.
And see the back.
Still
fighting.
I finally broke down today. It's Ed. I'm going to have to come and see you.
Okay, so she's
our position is in October. She's not good. And there's no sure, any time of what's going to actually for the most recent station to charge that. So
yeah,
we need to review this and say
yeah.
And knock it down, and I think yeah. She's probably.
So I told, and
maybe she hasn't done it as aggressively as we might, but she's done that a little bit. At least I don't think she's made her actions.
I was gonna write up something like similar.
It still wasn't an issue, whatever. She's top of the fee at all.
So you get to your own. events as much as
you have to be okay with us calling support for some more citizens.
He'll need to buy you some white noise canceling or something or another.
He
He needs all the help he can get. Back to it.
Necessity, those are kind of the more, at least high dollar value, but more complex cases that you get into. I'll give a brief overview of the anatomy of a med mal case. The way it was described to me when I first started doing this work, it's not the law that's complicated, it's the medicine. And in order to either bring or defend these suits, you really need to have an in-depth knowledge of medicine, or at least as much as you can without a medical degree. We've got new degree causation damages. I'll touch on a couple points of Nebraska law that may be useful. Duty, arises out of the physician-patient relationship. It's that relationship that engenders the duty. There has yet to be a Nebraska Supreme Court case where they have found duty existing in the absence of a physician-patient relationship. There's some dicta suggesting that that's not necessarily foreclosed. I think if I'm speculating or looking into a crystal ball, I think telehealth and telemedicine is going to bring some interesting issues into the analysis of duty. But as it stands, first place we look was there a physician-patient relationship? And a good example is a case from the early 90s, in your office handle, where there's an infant in the NICU, and there's a PA that's attending to the infant, and the baby's yellowish-green, and the PA turns to the physician that's standing over another infant next to her and says, I've got this severely or fairly jaundiced baby, what do I do? Here's some test results, what would be a reasonable approach? And the physician who's this is not the physician's patient, but gives kind of a drive-by concept type opinion and says, well, here's what I do, PA follows it, bad outcome, right? The issue for the Nebraska Supreme Court is, was there a physician-patient relationship? The magic words or the analysis that the court goes to is, did the physician undertake treatment of the patient? And that's going to be fact-intensive, it's factual inquiry. But that's the first place we look. And then breach, obviously the duty to act
reasonably under the circumstances. Paraphrase, I don't need to read the entire definition from the Nebraska Hospital Liability Act, but what would an ordinarily prudent physician do? Exercise of ordinary care, skill, and diligence under the same circumstances in the same or similar manner.
And we, not to interrupt, but we had an interesting conversation about that while we were preparing for this, about kind of the difference between the standard of care in a critical access hospital in a small community versus in a major metropolitan area, and how it can be vastly different, but also, you know, completely the correct standard of care under certain circumstances, but in two different places.
Yeah, and there's really better trend in acknowledging a national standard of care under a lot of circumstances, and we have a little bit of authority to push back on that here in Nebraska. A couple of cases we can point to where we have a rural hospital, a critical access hospital, and the plaintiff's expert is touting their experience around Chicago and, you know, practicing these major metropolitan areas, never states that they're familiar with the standard of care in Boxing County. Never states that they're familiar with the type of practice necessarily that's being utilized. And those are foundational prerequisites.
So the Boxing County at all, and what's the standard?
What's that?
I mean, you talk about all the areas where we don't have professionals in the county at all. So
yeah.
Sit down in the county, but
well, it's a locality, same or similar locality. And so that's the language of statute, same or similar locality. That's increasingly being interpreted as essentially if you have a physician or an expert that's willing to say, I'm familiar with the standard as it's done in my major metropolitan area, and it's the same all across the country, and it's the same in the critical access hospital. The standard for, you know, interpreting a CT scan for radiologists is not going to be referred to in Chicago.
That's not so much. It means 600 years ago.
Right. The resources are different. I mean, in a community where there's no doctors and there's nurse practitioners versus Omaha, I mean, I think, yeah, that's when that kind of comes into
it. Yeah. And from the plaintiff side of things, it's really a vetting process. At the outset, when we were asking to review the cases, you know, do they have the requisite experience to be able to say that they truly are familiar with this, and will they hold up when we get them to the deposition and we pin down specifically what their experience is, if they truly are familiar with it. Those are the check the box issues where you're looking for an expert to review the case. Causation, more likely than not, reasonable degree of medical certainty, it's 51%. There are, Supreme Court will say there's no magic words, but it has to have a sufficient level of certainty in order to be admissible and help with the trier of fact, meaning it has to be sufficiently definite as to the outcome. You know, one dividing line is if an expert reviews a case and says, well, you know, the negligence here really caused the patient to lose the chance of a better outcome, right? Nebraska has rejected the loss of chance doctrine to where the chance of a better outcome is not compensable damage. It's sometimes confused with the causation element being sufficiently certain in whether or not the negligence did lead to a bad outcome. So there's a little bit of overlap there, but it's generally the same idea that your expert needs to be sufficiently certain in giving that causation opinion. Again, if they are giving their opinion in terms of this would have helped, or I wish the doctor would have done this, you know, it could have, there's a possibility, there's a chance this outcome could have been avoided. That's right grounds for defense from my point of view. That's not going to be a
damages, we all know that the municipal damage is going to be the sticker price of your medical bills, not the discount amount because of insurance or other payments. But I will touch on one aspect of that that's different that I have encountered quite a bit, and that's the cases under where the providers are qualified under the law. And the Nebraska Hospital Medical Liability Act, if it's a case against a covered provider or a qualified provider, there's a statute that says we are entitled, me being a provider, in the event of an adverse judgment, to an offset against any judgment for the difference between the amount that has been paid by any non-reimbursable medical benefits, so any insurance payment, and the non-covered case. So I'll read the language for you so it's not misunderstood here. It says, there are two requirements to be a qualified provider under the Act. There's filing the proof of financial responsibility with the Director of Insurance, which means that whether you are an individual provider, a physician group, a hospital, you need to file proof that you have insurance at the statutory limits, which are $300,000 per occurrence. $1 million per year per physician, $500,000 for a hospital. You file for financial responsibility, and then you also pay the statutory surcharge, which currently is 45% as of January 1st, 2019, of your insurance premiums. So 145% of your insurance premium is what you're essentially paying. That extra 45%. Goes into the excess liability fund that will cover any excess damages of the cap amount, which we can talk about in our 10 minutes that we've got on that left. But once you meet those two requirements, that's the level as I understand it, of 45%, statutory limit is 50%. It's not unprecedented in the size of this currently. I think it's 2003. It was at the maximum. It's been raised from 40 to 45 for 2019. That's a reflection of a number of factors, the number of cases, number of judgments. But those are your two requirements involved. There's an additional requirement under the Act to post notice that you are qualified and of the patient's opportunity to withdraw from the Act. But that is not a prerequisite to being a qualified provider. That's a Supreme Court case over the last couple of years, that it's not a requirement to be qualified on your payments. So the Act dates back to 1976. The reason was to provide affordable professional liability insurance for providers in our state. It's what makes practicing medicine in our state particularly attractive, or at least relatively attractive, compared to other states, and that's why insurance premiums are relatively low. The benefit for the defense side, and you as a person on the plaintiff side, is for qualified providers, it caps the amount of damages. Total damages, both economic and non. And Nebraska is unique in that respect. We're one of three, I believe, currently states that caps both economic and non-economic damages. So the majority of states that have caps in medical malpractice cases as to non-economic damages, we also cap economic. And it's been challenged, like in other states, repeatedly. As of 2017, there was a case that was in the headlines, a $17 million verdict. It was reduced to the limit of, I think it was 1.75 at the time. Took it
out to be a surrogate, a sort of confirmed consistency to prior Supreme Court decisions that we have as to its constitutionality on various grounds. Supreme Court denied certiorari as of 2017. So, as it stands, our act, and specifically the cap on both categories of damages, is constitutional. There are other states where you can look to where the arguments have been successful overturning that constitutional balance, but it stands out to the lines. Current limit is $2.25 million. What that means, if you never dealt with it, is to take an example from 2 weeks ago, a verdict in Madison County, Nebraska, against a healthcare provider over an injury during a lap pulling procedure of $3.3 million. The trial court, because the defendant is qualified under the act, the trial court reduces that amount to $2.25. Where does that $2.25 come from? The provider, if they're qualified under the act, pays their limit of $500,000. The rest comes from the excess liability fund. The excess liability fund would be maintained by the director of insurance. Some of you have dealt with Mike Davlin, who is the director of the fund. There are notification requirements to notify the fund if you have a case that looks like it's going to involve the fund. If you have any questions, we'll go into more detail. Really, if you're looking at this from the plaintiff's point of view, you're thinking about taking a MedMal case. There's one right that you have under the act that is rarely utilized, but I can think of a situation where it may be useful, and that's the right to submit your claim to the medical panel for review prior to filing your claim. In every case I've been involved with under the act, the plaintiffs have waived that right and simply filed their complaint with the court, but essentially, I'm glossing over a number of details, but essentially you have the right to submit your complaint to a medical review panel that's comprised of professionals and an attorney, and they will render a decision for you.